So thank you everyone for coming today. Excited to be hosting this speaker who is a friend of mine and a wonderful scholar who I met a few months ago at the at an NEH Summer Institute. So by way of introduction, I just want to, this is partly for a class I'm teaching and partly for a broader kind of approach to public history and history overall that I'm taking these days in my work. And so I wanted to give you a little bit of framing context for those of you who are not in my class. So beginning with the NEH and how important that has been, I just want to say this out loud, even though I'm speaking to the choir, that the support of NEH has been really foundational to building interdisciplinary collaborations outside of the university. So this particular summer institute was about humanities and sustainability, and it was held in Flagstaff, Arizona. And Eric Magrane, our speaker, who I'll tell you more about in just a second, was one of the only graduate students who was participating in the almost all faculty seminar. And this means that he is highly exceptional. He's about done this semester as well, and is someone who already had established himself as a professional before or during graduate school as a poet. So he was inspiring to a lot of the participants in this conference. So Eric's work is related to climate change and poetry and takes an interdisciplinary arts and humanities approach that I want to bring in more centrally to my practice of history and thinking about the ways that design and art might contribute to communicating environmental research, environmental or historical research to a public that's outside of the university. As a form of public service and also as a form of acting, you know, on our work that is going outside of the walls of the academy. So I'm kind of, you know, I see my work as a historian really not being based in sitting in a chair in front of a computer. I really feel much more energized by working in collaborative groups and working with people in the community. And so thank you for all of you for coming here. And now I will give a few words about Eric, our speaker. So as I mentioned, he's a geographer and a poet. He's a co-editor of the Sonoran Desert, A Literary Field Guide, which is this book. Those of you in my public history seminar have read this for today. This is one of the reasons I was so excited about this book. And this approach is, this is a literary field guide, which means, as he's going to explain further, there is a combination of poetry, illustration, and also ecological information about real species in the Sonoran Desert. So this is some ecological information. So thinking about how we might document practices, processes of change on the landscape, this strikes me as something that, a method that historians might think through as a way of both analyzing and communicating information about the environment through time. So this book has won the 2016 Southwest Book of the Year, and I will point out that it's a collaborative project. Other academic and creative works by Eric have recently appeared in GeoHumanities, Ecotone, ACME, an International Journal for Critical Geographies, Cultural Geographies, and several others. He is also a founding editor of Spiral Orb, which is a experiment in permaculture poetics, and Eric will be telling us more about various of these projects. He's also the poet in residence at the Arizona Sonora Desert Museum and has many other affiliations around the country with different scholars. So you just came from a environmental humanities conference as well, the DOPE conference.
In Kentucky.
Yeah. In Kentucky. Also a product partly of collaborations from this summer. So without further ado, we'll have plenty of time to discuss his work. I would like to present you Eric Magrane.
Thank you, Kristen, and thank you everyone for being here, for welcoming me here. I think One of the things that we've been talking about this morning, we went out to Baytown this morning, where some of us I know are going to go to tomorrow. And I've been wrapping my mind around the way that I think about space and about my work, blending geography and poetry and doing work that goes out in the world in multiple realms in terms of, you know, putting scholarly articles out, putting, you know, creative projects out, doing art exhibits. And there's some really interesting, you know, intersections with the way that Kristen is thinking about, you know, public humanities, with the way that you think about public humanities here. And I just want to say that I've been, you know, greatly inspired by, you know, all of our conversations individually and at that NEH Institute that Kristen mentioned. I'm really looking forward to the conversations here as well. So what I'm going to do today is actually speak about three specific projects. This will kind of be the center of it, but I'm gonna talk about two other projects as well, as projects that I think of as both geographic practice and as, you know, creative practice, as critical and creative practice, engaging with stories and landscapes and, you know, narrative and space, and kind of paying attention to what's happening in a site, right, or in a place, and building some research or some work that interacts with that in some way. So the three examples are going to be, first, the project at the Arizona Sonora Desert Museum, which is a collaboration between myself, the Desert Museum, I'll tell you what that is in a minute, and the University of Arizona Poetry Center. The second is this book, The Sonoran Desert Literary Field Guide, so I'll describe this, do a few readings from this. And then finally, I want to speak about a current project that I'm working on that is around bycatch in the Gulf of California shrimp trawler fisheries, and that's a collaborative project where I'm playing artist in that project. My collaborator is playing scientist, but it's an art-science project where artists and scientists were paired together. And my collaborator and I, neither of I fit into like artist or scientist kind of, we can't figure out which one of us is which in that project. And I'll tell you some about that when we get to that. But to start, why don't we start with the Desert Museum? Okay. Has anyone been to Tucson or the Desert Museum? Okay, so yes. Yeah, have you, Tucson and the Desert Museum? Okay, so you know the space. The Desert Museum is a bit of a misnomer for Desert Museum. It's a natural history museum, bioregional zoo, and botanical gardens, okay? There's about 500,000 people that come through there every year. And I've been part of this project with the Desert Museum and with the University of Arizona Poetry Center in designing small pieces, small fragments of poems to place in the Desert Museum grounds as another way of interpreting the history, the natural history that's happening there, okay? So as one of the, if not the luscious deserts in the world, the Sonoran Desert extends across, you know, the current geopolitical lines of the US and Mexico, hence the Arizona Sonora in its name. And the Desert Museum has long fostered relationships between naturalists and researchers on both sides of the border, as well as with the people of indigenous nations, including the Tonalotum, which are in the southern Arizona and northern Sonora region, and the Comcoc, or Seri, in Sonora. So in this collaboration, I've curated selections of poetry to install around the Desert Museum grounds in different forms. And our project is based in part on a project called Woven Words, a project called Language of Conservation, which placed poets in zoos across the country to, you know, use, you know, poetry as other ways of interpreting the story there and other ways of engaging visitors in the interpretation of this site. Research on that project showed that interpretation, those poems placed within the grounds, had a positive effect. Okay, the way that they, some work was done surveying visitors, you know, pre and post these, you know, short pieces of poetry, and thinking about how people experienced conservation themes in working through the ground. So we're sort of building on that. And when I put my social science hat on, I think about, you know, that question. But the thing is that this is a placemaking project that reaches a large public audience, and this is one of the connections in thinking about, you know, and myself thinking about, you know, the in context of public history. So the project for me as a researcher allows me to put something out into the world, you know, poetry in different sites within the museum, but then to sit back and see how people and bodies interacting with it, okay, and engage with it, and think about what sort of encounters and experiences happen, you know, through that. So I just wanted to share three of the brief installations that illustrate the way we're thinking about them. So has anyone seen a scorpion before? Yeah, scorpion? You know, scorpion? Okay, cool. So yeah. Are there scorpions here in Houston? No? Okay.
In West Texas.
North Texas. Okay. So we've got plenty of scorpions at the Desert Museum. And that's one of the things. So in the summertime, the Desert Museum is open at night. And one of the things that people love to do is to bring black lights, okay, to shine against the stone walls to see scorpions. Because I don't know if you've seen that. It's really cool. They iridesce. They glow in the black light. So, you know, here's an this is one of the stone walls that people will use to shine against that. So in thinking about how to place poetry within the Desert Museum grounds, I was thinking about, okay, what's happening there? And this encounter between people shining the black lights for the scorpions always really struck me, and it's something that I love to do. So I started to think, you know, just my poet me started to think, are there any poems that would glow in black light? Right? So I asked Alberto Rios, who's the Arizona State Poet Laureate, if he had any one-line scorpion poems, because he has this great series of flora and fauna poems, one-line Gregorias. It's based on a Spanish form that he's sort of translated. And he sent me two for the scorpion. And one is, scorpions are lobsters sent west by the Witness Protection Program, right? Which was fabulous. We haven't put that one up yet. And the other is, the scorpion carries on its back the question mark of its existence, right? Which is like, there's so many resonances for that line. I mean, for me, it works in multiple ways, right? So the scorpion carries on its back the question mark existence. You can look at that metaphorically, you can look at that philosophically, but there's also, it refers also to scorpions carry their young on their backs, their babies on their backs, until the exoskeleton comes in. So there's a natural history embedded within that line of poetry, right? So what we did is we painted that in blacklight paint on the stone wall so that when the people came by, okay, they're looking for scorpions, right? And all of a sudden, there's like a scorpion walking through the word scorpion. I just geeked out on that. I sat back and watched and was like, you know. And then, you know, there's scorpion walking through that line. So the poem becomes line kind of like a hidden message interpreting the site. I sat back the first night we had it installed. I don't know if you can you see this okay? Yeah. And so you can see kind of a little bit of the outline of the words coming through here. There's family, you know, looking at it, and one of the parents said one of the kids, oh, what do you think that has to do with? And one of the kids, I'm not making this up, I would make it up because it would work well for a story, but one of the kids said, oh, I get that. I learned about how they carry their babies on their back, right? So it kind of, you know, was this sort of intermediary in that natural history story, another way of telling that story rather than, you know, sort of, you know, drier kind of, you know, natural history interpretation and plates. So that's one of the examples from the Desert Museum. For another, excuse me, for another example, the Desert Museum asked me to come up with a poem to go with a mural of a riparian scene, right? So with a river scene, okay? And so, I mean, we're far from as humid as you are here in Houston, but as deserts go, Sonoran Desert is one of the luscious deserts in the world, and there's great biodiversity for a desert. And part of it's because of two rainy seasons. Still, depending upon where you're measuring, you know, that's 10 to 12 inches a year. So it's not that much, but as desert goes, it's that. So with ongoing drought and climate change, right, less predictable weather patterns are projected in the Southwest, and water is a big issue, right? So Sonoran Desert is part of the larger Colorado River Basin, and we're one of seven Western states that take water from the basin, and that, you know, historically flowed all the way to the Gulf of California, which is sometimes, you know, called the Sea of Cortez. Aldo Leopold, who was actually one of the founding, you know, figures around our institute this summer, he wasn't there. He's been gone for a while. We read Aldo Leopold Sand County Almanac and some of his writings as a way to think through current environmental humanities questions. But he went down the Delta in 1922 and wrote of 100 green lagoons, I'm quoting him here, and a wealth of fowl and fish. So he wouldn't recognize it today. There was a a document, a 1922 Colorado River Compact. So I'm a poet getting into policy here for just a minute. There's a Colorado River Compact in 1922 that essentially is still the guiding policy document dividing up the water from the Colorado River. Okay, and the allotments in the compact were actually based on acre feet amounts of water that are unlikely to exist in our shifting climate, or actually in the historical record, as it turns out, as some of my colleagues who do tree ring dating have demonstrated. So, you know, we know the story due to a series of dams, agriculture, industry, and the growing population's thirst for water. The Colorado River hasn't regularly flowed all the way to its natural outlet in the Gulf for close to 50 years. That is, not really until recently, when a recent agreement between US and Mexico, Minute 319, someone heard of that? Yeah. Minute 319 actually allowed for occasional pulse flows to begin to restore the delta. So the idea is that that agreement, policy agreement, allowed for occasional flows to go all the way to the delta to see what would happen in sort of, you know, repopulating the riparian habitat. So all this is to say, when the Desert Museum asked me to go to come up with a poem to go along with the riparian mural, I started thinking about the pulse flow and I started thinking about water policy. So I sat down as a poet and as a geographer to start to read through those policy documents to see if I could find any poetry in the policy documents. And I looked for flourishes of language. I think it's the sound of a river kind of, you know, going through that. We'll see if that
that is not supposed to be
out. Yeah. There we go, that sounds better. Cool. So so here's some of the language from the policy documents that I was reading, right? And I was reading these trying to think of, okay, can I like extract any little pieces of language to kind of make poems out of to kind of interpret this? So here's one of them. Minute 319 represents a further agreement by the United States and Mexico to work towards addressing these considerations by implementing several of these options and activities. So I was like, no, not quite poetry. The term Colorado River System means that portion of the Colorado River and its tributaries within the United States of America. So ultimately what I did is I chose four phrases, two from each document. The phrases were tributaries within, present and future, of new water, and pulse flow. And each of those I used as the first line of a short poem that I then wrote based on that, that's now etched into the window at the cafe. So I'm just one of them, I think we have up here. So this is an example of one of them. Tributaries within our thoughts are a river's memory of a bird just alight from a branch on its banks. So this then, you know, that stiff like officialese of water policy is really, you know, difficult to turn into poetry, but it can have, you know, poetic effects on the landscape. Like that Minute 319 and some of the people that are doing research now in terms of what species are coming back and like the effect that that's having on the delta can have those poetic responses. And this poem becomes sort of an intermediary between that story of the water policy and, you know, people who visit the museum. And we have a short interpretive sign by it that contextualizes it a little bit in terms of policy. Okay, so I'm gonna show one more from the Desert Museum and then use that as a way to get into this book. And the other one is at the Hummingbird Aviary, okay? So Hummingbird, do you remember going to the Hummingbird Aviary? Yeah, it's a great spot. You walk inside, it's maybe a little bit bigger than this room, it's round, and there's all kinds of hummingbirds zipping around, right? There's you know, at different times, you know, 5 to 7 species of hummingbirds that live in there. So when I first actually came to the Sonoran Desert and first was introduced to the desert museum and to the desert, and this was in 1999, I think it was, I heard this story about the Hummingbird Aviary, where the story was that they had renovated the aviary in the early 90s. So in doing so, they pulled all of the birds out, then they pulled all the plants out. They did what they had to do in the renovation, reintroduced the plants and reintroduced the birds. Okay? And they found after reintroducing the birds, when they tried to raise young, their nests weren't holding together, and they weren't they weren't able to raise young. So after a little bit of scratching of heads, the keepers realized, oh, what we've done is when we took everything out, we took the spiders out, we took the spider webs out, right? And hummingbirds need the spider webs to help hold their nests together. So they went around the grounds, gathered spider webs, reintroduced them to the aviary, and after that, it all worked out well. They were able to raise young. So it's just kind of a simple story. It's like the ecological idea of interrelation. You pull one thing out, and it affects everything else. That's a real kind of basic ecological interaction story. And when I used to, so for a number of years, I worked as a hiking guide in the in the desert as well. And that's a story that I'd used, when I was doing bird walks and talking about hummingbirds for that. One of my favorite poems of all time, coincidentally, is by the Japanese, the 18th century haiku master Isa. Japanese haiku master Isa. And the translation of the poem is, "Don't worry, spiders, I keep house casually." Right? I just love that poem. I mean, when I first met the poem, when I was an undergrad studying poetry, it struck me. Don't worry, spiders, I keep house casually. Because there's this surface simplicity to it, but there's so much depth to that poem. Like house, like what is that? I mean, I use that sometimes when I want to get out of cleaning house with my partner, I say, well, remember that Isa poem. But there's also just, I mean, so many, metaphorical ways of reading that house, in terms of an individual, a body. But house, thinking as a geographer now, thinking about house and oikos, right? The house and home, right? So what we did is we put that poem on the outside of the hummingbird aviary. And now, I don't know if you can see this here, but it says, "Don't worry, spiders, I keep house casually," on the doors entering and exiting the aviary, right? So that poem kind of becomes an intermediary between that story of the hummingbird renovation and the history of that, really, on the site, and the docents who, I told that story of, okay, why we chose this poem, so they interpret it, differently through that poem, right? So those are just kind of a few examples of the things that I've been doing at the Desert Museum, just to give you an idea of sort of the practice that I want to talk about today, and that we'll think about tomorrow for those of you who are joining us tomorrow as well too. The practice in terms of sort of working with sites, paying attention to what happens in a site, and sort of doing something with that site that builds on it and shifts it maybe in a little bit of a different way, and shifts the audience in a little bit of a different way. So next, I'd like to talk about this book that I know some of you know about. So this is, as Kristen said, it's a project that kind of blends genres. It's a combination field guide and literary anthology. And one of the things that I think a lot about in all of these projects, working with sites and sense of place, is form, and how, as I said at the beginning, how producing things in different forms, go out in the world and do different kinds of work. So to give you an idea of how this book works, I wanted to read some of the pieces from it. And I'm going to start by reading the short introduction. It's just about 4 or 5 minutes. And this will, some of you may have read this already, but this will give you an idea of how we sort of situate this book. And you'll see some echoes to what I was speaking about with the Desert Museum examples as well. "The faculty of wonder," writes naturalist and author Joseph Wood Crouch, "tires easily. Among other things, then, this is a book to exercise with, literally. Take a walk in the Sonoran Desert with this literary field guide, and you can learn some of the desert's names and lives and gain new appreciations of both. This is one way to overcome a neophyte's inability to see nuances, and a way to refresh a resident's inability to see again something seen many times before. My own homely technique when I walk out and realize that I am in danger of seeing nothing at all," Crouch continues, "is simply to greet each thing as it comes along, by name, if I know it. Perhaps this book is also a kind of etiquette manual, full of names that you can use to greet the Sonoran Desert, the luscious desert in the world. This is a land of paradoxical austerity and bounty. After all, luscious desert sounds a bit like jumbo shrimp, a contradiction almost comic. But it's true. It's a place not with 4 seasons, but 5. Summer is divided into an arid foresummer and a rainy season of violent downpour. It's a place that during a hot midday will seem barren of animal life, though, really, the critters are there, quietly waiting in shadows. We think of Richard Shelton's poem, Desert, from his collection, The Bus to Veracruz. And this is a quote from Dick Shelton's poem. Those who have lived here longest and know best are least conspicuous. The oldest mountains are lowest, and the scorpion sleeps all day beneath a broken stone. It's a place where seeds are patient, blossoms can open at night, and strange-seeming succulents called saguaro take a year to grow a half inch, and then live 2 centuries, towering in forests on the desert floor and rocky foothills. Here, native cultures have thrived for thousands of years. Here, barbs snag, thorns prick, and claws scratch. Lizards scramble and pause, quail sound like primates, hawks hunt like wolves, and a bobcat skulks in creosote, eyeing a kangaroo rat. This book gathers creative responses, poetry and prose, to some of the iconic and more obscure plants and animals of this region. However, this volume is no mere anthology. It is also a field guide with information, often playful but accurate, on the habitats, appearances, and life histories of plants, invertebrates, birds, mammals, reptiles, and amphibians. Paul Marocca's illustrations give a visual reference for the species included. We could say this book is a form of literary biomimicry, in which the varieties of form and style mirror the diversity of species in the desert. This volume includes a range of contributors, both well-known and emerging. Just as the species included here are only a small sampling of the many who call the Sonoran Desert home, the writers included are but one part of the breadth and vibrancy of the literary community connected with this desert, and in particular, the area of the Sonoran Desert in the Tucson region called Arizona Upland. Scientists tell us that we are in the midst of a new geologic epoch called the Anthropocene, one marked by wide-scale human impact on the biosphere. Human-caused global warming, habitat destruction, and extreme biodiversity loss are among the litany of environmental challenges we currently face. Here in the Sonoran Desert, a warming climate portends drought and increased wildfire activity. The current ecological makeup of the bioregion will change. In 100 years, will we look at some of the pieces in this book as elegies for species past? In 10,000 years, what will have vanished? What will have persisted? What will have arrived? Increasingly, people across different walks of life and different disciplines realize that no single way of thinking will get us where we need to go. We should bring all of our faculties to reimagining how we live in places and among our neighbors of all species. We need biodiversity of thought. The empiricism of science, the imaginative and cognitive leaps of poetry, the close observation of both, we need it all. It is in this spirit that we offer this book. We hope it encourages wonder and, hand in hand with that wonder, acts as an invitation to know the Sonoran Desert with emotion as well as reason, with increased empathy for each other and for the other inhabitants of this sharp and amazing place. So this is a project really that I think about as a project about community in the broadest sense, right? So we reached out to 60 to 65 different, and I'll pass around a copy for those who haven't seen it. Feel free to take a look through to see what the book looks like. 60 to 65 different poets and prose writers, and I assigned them species to write to. You know, I said, okay, this is your species. Some of them requested them. Some of them I gave 2 choices. They got to choose. It kind of varied by each individual, and I gave them sort of a line length or a word length if they were writing prose. And how they decided to go about that was up to them. So there were interesting questions in terms of, okay, what sort of ethics comes with sort of writing to another species or in the voice of another species, or you know, how they, you know, about another species. You know, as a geographer, I'm always thinking about, we were having this conversation last night, I think, too, always thinking about prepositions being so important, because there's kind of this, the most relational, you know, phrases, you know. So that choice that each poet or writer made is very varied. So we think of this as sort of a multivocal work, right? So to give you an idea of how some of the poems work, I'm going to read a few of the poems from this to give you an idea, and a few of the field guide entries to give you an idea of how those sound and how we wrote those, how we're trying to be both scientifically accurate but, you know, playful and, you know, kind of little asides in them as well. And I'll show you a few pictures from the book, but it's coming around. So actually, I'll start with the saguaro. folks know the saguaro? So the saguaro is the if the cactus like this, with the arms, it's kind of the postcard cactus, right? It's actually one of the keynote species of the Sonoran Desert. It's really only grows in the Sonoran Desert and only up to about 4,500 feet elevation. You know, where I live in the basin of Tucson, we're at about 2,400 feet elevation. The mountains go up over 9,000 feet. And, if you go up the mountains, you can see right at about 4,000, 4,500 feet, there's only like a few kind of avant-garde saguaro kind of on the edge, but they stay down there. But they're very iconic, right? And they can live for a couple hundred years. So the poet Alison Hawthorne Deming wrote the saguaro. She wrote two pieces. I'm just going to read one of them. And this is actually, she wrote a series of questions to the saguaro. Okay, so it's kind of an interesting tact in thinking about her relationship with the saguaro. And she was both serious and playful with it. So this is Alison Deming's questions for a saguaro. And she has an epigraph by the poet Sheshwa Miloche. And the epigraph is, excuse me, not that I want to be a god or a hero, just to change into a tree, grow for ages, not hurt anyone. Questions for a saguaro. If it takes you 100 years to grow your first arm, for how long do you feel the sensation of craving something new? Did you ever feel impatient those years after someone put a shirt over your head, and even with spines cutting through denim, it took decades to grow your way out of confinement? Does it feel like greed or self-actualization when rain comes and you suck it up as fast as you can, even if you starve the mesquite that sheltered your youth? Do you ever say to yourself, mindlessly, wordlessly, God, it's too effing hot? Or after the monsoon, I feel so bloated. Or before, I'm so parched. Sometimes people are thrilled to see you spread out in disarray like soldiers off duty forever in the contemplative desert. Does anything thrill you? A mountain lion scratching its backside on your spines? Growing taller than your nurse tree? Flowers erupting from your head? Your fruit packs seeds that can move what you've learned from your one rooted spot into new places called the future. Does it feel like release or satisfaction or nothing when those time capsules plummet to the ground? So that's Allison's poem to the saguaro. I'm going to do another plant here. I'm going to do the jumping cholla. Has anyone met a jumping cholla? Yeah? How was that meeting?
I didn't meet it. She didn't receive it very well.
Cactuses and
things.
Okay, yeah. So the jumping cholla, if you picture, has a habit of jumping and attaching to people as they're walking through the desert. So I'm going to read Logan Phillips's poem to the jumping cholla to give you an idea of just some of the different forms that these works take. And I'll read our field guide entry. So when I say our, my co-editor and I, Chris Kokinos, and I wrote the field guide entries for each of these species. We wrote those collaboratively. So here's Logan's poem to the jumping cholla, a synonymic description. And this you'll hear kind of works more with, does a different thing with language than Allison's poem does. Fortress of wren, holder of nest, needled crib, godfather to egg, aflame in dawnlight, the wren call. Jumping cholla, la brincadora, la viajera, la vella de coyote, alight in a lightness of being, borderless. Drinker of sand, halo of bones, chain hanger, cylindropuntia filguida, a bit of sun, earth fallen, taken a root. Spear-haired trickster, dagger-eyed freeloader, angelic bonsai, skeleton of desert corral, all juxtapositions endemic to desert. Thick-skinned traveler, mohawked hitchhiker, along for the ride, stuck on my boot. And here's the field guide entry that Chris and I wrote for it. So each field guide entry has a habitat, description, and life history. Here's the habitat. Cactus forests. Riding along on boots, socks, human skin, or animal fur, common in much of the Sonoran Desert. Description: a regalia of branches, a spectacle of arms. Though many will swear to the contrary, a jumping cholla doesn't really jump. Neither does a porcupine shoot its quills. Cartoonist Reg Manning's 1941 paperback, What Kind of Cactus Is That?, puts it this way: it is simply a painful illusion. The thorn is quicker than the thigh. Life history. The arms do release easily. Look around the ground next to a cholla and you're likely to see lots of joints that have fallen from the cactus. This is a primary means for new cholla's to take root. If you're a deer browsing on a nearby tuna, the prickly pear fruit, not the fish, right? So tuna is a word for the prickly pear fruit, and brush into a cholla, then you might carry an arm along with you when you go, and in turn help to spread the cholla. This cactus is the reason that many professional guides in the desert carry combs with them. A comb placed in between a branch of a cholla and human skin can help to propel the cholla branch out of the skin. Just check to make sure that no one is standing in the direction the cholla segment is about to fly. Right? So you see, we tried to get some natural history into those stories, and we actually, in writing those field guide entries, it was fun, we actually worked at the a research library at Tumamak Hill, which is a site of long-term ecological research, and we were surrounded by all kinds of old scientific papers, all kinds of old books, and we had stacks of old field guides as well too. So for example, that was a 1941 field guide that we referenced in it. So we're kind of bringing quotes from past field guides into conversation with what we were saying, and sort of playing with the form of field guide entries. Okay, so let's see. Why don't we do a bird? I'm gonna do a Harris's hawk. This is by the poet Maria Elena Wakamatsu. And she, it's called Halcón. So Halcón is Spanish for Harris's hawk. You are dark brown, almost black like me. Your shoulders, the color of the red earth I come from. Scientists call you Harris's hawks, Parabutio unicinctus, but I know you as dusky angels. Nene, Chiquito, and Brianna, my Chihuahua, Jack Russell, and tortoiseshell tabby all know you're here. They smell your wildness. They feel your gaze. They do not run. Early morning walkers on Tumamak witness the thwack thwack of wings and behold your glide through sweet cantaloupe skies. Little children in the wash behind my house watch you chase your friends through Palo Verde and mesquite thick with creamy pods and tow. Small mice scurry along moist sand. Pack rats tremble in the brush. Rabbits freeze, pretend to be invisible. Mourning doves do not coo. All understand balance, and the desert is thankful you are here. In the early morning shadows, I see you in the trees. I know you hear Aurora's music, and I am thankful you are here. And here's the field guide entry for the Harris hawk. Habitat. Mesquite and saguaro. Desert scrub. Look for groups perched atop arms of the same saguaro. In season, a family of Harris's hawks can also be found performing in the Arizona Sonora Desert Museum's Raptor Free Flight. Description. The hawk, formerly known as dusky hawk or bay-winged hawk, is dark brown with shoulders alternately described as chestnut or rufous. John James Audubon gave the name Harris's hawk after Edward Harris, a close friend of Audubon's, who also helped finance Audubon's Birds of America. Sibley points out that it has excipitor-like proportions but broader-winged, stockier. Excipitors, such as the Cooper's hawk, also common in the Sonoran Desert, have long tails and are more agile in flight than the stockier butios, such as red-tailed hawks, soaring high above. They are 20 inches in length with a wingspan of about 3.5 feet. Life history. In the Southwest, cooperative family groups hunt together. Birds on the ground flush rodents, rabbits, or other prey out into the open so that another in the pack can swoop down for the catch. The Cornell Lab of Ornithology reports that, quote, groups of five are most successful. The Harris's hawk is also known to practice his untraditional family structure known as cooperative simultaneous polyandry. One female hawk will take multiple male mates, and they will rear the young birds in one big, presumably to anthropomorphize here, happy family. So we had fun playing with those field guide entries. I'll read a reptile and an amphibian, and then a tree, and then We'll probably switch on to the third example that I want to give today, but I'm going to read the Gila monster. Because the Gila monster, has anyone seen the Gila monster or know about the Gila monster? Right. So it's one of the, yeah? Have you met, I can't even say, have you met one of them? Like, the, yeah, but you've seen them before? Or?
Yeah, I've seen them before.
Okay, whereabouts?
I saw them once at the Houston Zoo.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, they're, I've never been bitten one, but I hear like, I think it's in this here, I hear like it's like taking glass and rubbing it through your, you know, through your skin, so I wouldn't, you know, want to do that. But there's really interesting life history with the Gila monster as well, too. So this poem is actually one of the poems that I contributed to the book. So I'll read my short poem to the Gila monster, and then I'll read the field guide entry. Gila monster. Under summer bajadas and winter foothills, it is, mostly, a subterranean life. What is known above ground and what is known below ground have been sequestered into different fields of meaning. Orange and black, red and black, bright pink and black, beady lizard, family of warty skin, quail eggs to eat. It looks like rain is coming, but it isn't. So that's the short poem, and here's the field guide entry. Habitat. Mountain foothills, washes, but mostly underground. Description. The trailer for the 1959 movie, The Giant Gila Monster, describes, quote, an amazing Kong-like monster terrifying an entire population, devouring people as if they were flies. In reality, they grow only to about 1.5 feet long, black with orange-pink splotches, or we suppose you could say orange-pink, with black splotches. Its family name refers to its warty, beady skin. You might call a Gila monster chunky. It is able to store fat in its tail. The largest lizard native to the US and the only venomous lizard in the US. Here's the life history. More conflicting statements are made about the Gila monster than about any other desert reptile, reports Nat N. Dodge in his Poisonous Dwellers of the Desert booklet. One of the myths claims that a Gila monster is venomous because it has no anus. Not true. There, it's out there, that story, right? So that's there's some connection with history or narrative there somehow. If we could translate, would a Gila monster also have crazy stories about humans? Perhaps the stories grow out of the secretive nature of Gila monsters. Only recently have researchers begun to make inroads into their nesting behavior in the wild. Also, it's not clear whether the Gila monster's venom is used for immobilizing prey or as a defense mechanism. However, drugs made from its venom and other bodily fluids help control type 2 diabetes and show promise in fighting Alzheimer's disease. Okay? So you see how, you know, we're using that form to kind of bring, you know, multiple ways of, or I hope is, multiple ways of knowledge or knowing into, you know, into presenting these species and their cultural and social relationships as well, too. And, you know, if you've seen, those of you that have seen the book, and as it's coming around, you know, we kind of played with the form of the page, too, where, you know, here, for example, is a poem by the Tonaltim poet Ophelia Zepeda, and Creosote in both English and Altim, the field guide entry, and then Paul Marocco, who did the illustrations, breaks down the drawing of the creosote leaf as a way to think through some of the natural history of the creosote leaf. Here's an example. Oh, this is another one of Tito, of Alberto Rios's one-line poems, like the scorpion one I told you. He contributed the hummingbird one for this. Hummingbirds are quarter notes which have left the nest of the flute, right? So you can see kind of the play with the design of the book as well. Here's a very short desert tortoise poem by Wendy Burke. Sometimes the one still point in the center of the landscape is moving. Kind of. So it's kind of referring to the tortoise, but it's kind of, you know, thinking about, you know, location and placement. And, you know, as a geographer, you know, I geek out on that stuff. But also thinking about the form of the page as well, too, kind of like the geography of the page itself. If you have this book, this kind of goes through, this is the gutter, right? So the poem moves across the gutter of the page, you know, the tortoise over there. So, you know, working with design of the form of the book as a way of sort of, you know, representing space as well as something that we're playing with in this. So I'm going to read one more poem and field guide entry from the book, and this is one of the other poems that I have in the book, and this is the Velvet Mesquite. And mesquites, As you probably know mesquites a bit here, but mesquites have one of the deepest documented roots, right? The mesquite root has been found over 160 feet below the surface of the soil in southern Arizona, where I live. So in writing the poem, I tried to imagine what that deep taproot of a mesquite tree might have to say to a room full of humans. Usually when I'm in rooms, they're full of humans, so I get to kind of like practice it. So this is a poem in the voice of that deep taproot of the mesquite. And you'll hear multiple references here. Okay, there are historical references in terms of the mesquite when they're thought to have co-evolved with large herbivores, mastodons, and ground sloths. You know, well before I lived in the Sonoran Desert. You know, but cattle have recently taken up that mode, and their pods are traditionally used for a food in like the Hohokam and some of the people that have histories living in the canyons. You can find grinding stones where the pods have been used to grind down for flour. And with local food movements and permaculture practices, it's being taken up more as a local food. So you'll see kind of those references throughout the poem. So here's the poem. Mesquite. Down here, the layers of earth are comforting like blankets. The soil I think of as time. Below the caliche, I sift through sediment from thousands of years. Though the sharp desert light above is another world, its pulse courses through me. When the mastodons and ground sloths roamed, its pulse coursed through me. When the Hohokam in the canyon ground my pods in the stone, its pulse coursed through me. When the new gatherers of the desert learn again how to live here, its pulse will course through me. And I say, I will be ready if the drought comes. And I say, go deep into the earth. And I say, go deep into yourself. Go deep and be ready. And here's the field guide entry for the mesquite habitat. And you'll see references to some of the things that I said at the beginning of the poem. Widespread in the southwest, generally occurring below 5,000 feet elevation. The velvet mesquite prefers washes and floodplains, but is also found in drier areas. Researchers are currently studying the expansion of mesquite in grassland habitat, which has been likely aided by cattle eating the pods and redistributing seeds in their poop. Mesquites are often used as a native landscaping tree as well, and provide many uses in the urban environment, especially for those practicing permaculture, which models human systems after ecological systems for sustainable living. Description. The deciduous mesquite can grow into large trees up to 50 to 60 feet, but will often be smaller and shrubby in drier locations. Those who have pruned mesquite will warn you, beware its sharp spines. With wispy leaves, an extravagant exhibition of flowers arrives in the foresummer, often attracting a congress of bees. The pods resemble flattened green beans until they turn brown in the arid foresummer, at which point you should gather them, grind them into flour, and make some pancakes. Growing interest in desert food has even led to a cookbook produced by the group Desert Harvesters titled Eat Mesquite. Life history. A natural history of the Sonoran Desert tells us that mesquite co-evolved with large herbivores, such as mastodons and ground sloths, which ate the pods and then dispersed them widely in their feces. A tree might live individually for a couple hundred years. The tree's taproot is the deepest known and insurance policy for severe drought. It may also help redistribute the water from deep in the aquifer to the shrubs or young saguaros growing in its shade. It's a relationship called a mesquite guild. This collaborative assemblage and collectivity of species makes one wonder where one organism ends and another begins. So that kind of last line, that collaborative assemblage and collectivity of species makes one wonder where one organism ends and another begins. When I think about my work as a geographer and some of the kind of social theory that I build on, right? That's a way I think about that line, is kind of like putting that out there in a different form. That refers to some of the theory that I work with in thinking about non-human and human bodies and interactions and how we delineate what an individual is, what an organism, and many questions associated with that. So it's fun to kind of like take those ideas and put them into different forms. So I'm going to stop there with the Sonoran Desert and shift to one other project. And then I want to leave plenty of time so that we'll have a chance for some conversations and questions, any questions on this book or anything else. But I wanted to tell you a little bit about a project that I'm working on right now that takes other forms as well. This is, did anyone collect trading cards, like baseball cards or cards growing up or any types of, you know, cards? Used to, yeah, or used to. So I did when I was a kid, and I've always loved this form. So one of the things we did for this project is produce a series of collector's edition trading cards of bycatch. So as I tell you about this project, I'll pass these around so that you can see kind of what the cards look like and what the packaging looks like. You saw those, yeah. And I'll tell you a little bit about that project. So this is a co-produced art science project that revolves around bycatch. So bycatch is a term for all of the species caught in a fishery that are not the target species, right? So we're doing research on the shrimp trawling fishery in the Gulf of California, right? So I was talking about the Minute 319, which enters into the Gulf. If you see here, right, comes down in here. This is the Gulf of California, so Tucson, and right in here is where our research on this project is. And I'm collaborating with a marine conservationist who is also an artist, and I play geographer and poet in the collaboration. And what it's done is it has brought us out on trawler boats in the Gulf overnight. So we'll board the trawler boat at like 5 p.m., stay through 11 a.m. the next morning, and become, you know, part of what's happening on the boat. So to give you a little idea of what that looks like, I want to actually show you a little video of what bycatch looks like. Turn away if you get dizzy looking at something.
So all non-target species, right?
Pretty much. You can find, like, there's a shrimp.
Yeah, this is like, this is fishing for shrimp.
This is fishing for shrimp, yeah.
It's like 80% bycatch, right?
85 to 90% in that area. So the shrimp is being tossed into these baskets right there. And we're working to monitor to, you know, species of concern and kind of, you know, weigh the bycatch as well. So this is part of an ongoing scientific project that we're working with. But we're trying to think about how we'd approach this in an art science project. So the trawling season, okay, lasts from mid-September through mid-March. So shrimp trawlers are traversing the area of the Gulf where we're doing this research. And what I'm going to do is just read a short excerpt from an essay that we have on this project to give you an idea of what it sounds like. So each night, hundreds of boats drag their 100-foot-long nets across the sea floor in search of shrimp. Along with shrimp, they pull up over 200 other species. In fact, the vast majority of life that is dredged from the bottom of the Gulf is not shrimp. By weight, as you said, 85 to 90% of what is captured is bycatch. In Spanish, it's called basura, trash. There is an ecology, of course, to the trawler slicing through the Gulf. Sea lions trail the boat, waiting for bycatch to be shoveled off the deck. Pelicans arrive in the early night, followed by gulls in the hours after midnight and before sunrise, and by frigate birds when daylight breaks. 4 to 6 times each night, the nets are raised and the contents dropped on the boat's deck. Each of these is called a set. Fishermen toss shrimp into baskets, eel writhe with bronze-striped grunts and other fish in their mouths, crabs scurry to the corners, octopus climb the legs of fishermen, and fish mouths gape for underwater breath, only to find the unforgiving air of the international seafood trade. The crew is out for 40 days at a time. We arrived just for the night, ferried to the trawler by Panga, a small skiff used locally, and boarded at 5 p.m. We'll stay through 11 the next morning. We are here to study bycatch, to calculate the ratio of shrimp to bycatch, to record all the species captured throughout the night, and to take data on any species of particular concern, such as endangered species or those of high commercial importance. This is part of a research project that has been ongoing for close to 2 decades, based out of the Prescott College Kino Bay Center for Cultural and Ecological Studies. We are here particularly for an art science investigation of bycatch. A brief and partial inventory, the boat, chains, rope, wood, baskets, a frozen hull, winch, multiple Virgin Mary paintings, fishing gloves, barrels for shrimp heads, shovels to scrape the bycatch overboard. How can we make sense of this vessel pushing through the gulf as we are knee-deep in writhing sea life, hauled up from the benthic zone, our gloves stained through with fish slime? As we sort, the hull underneath is a repository of flash-frozen shrimp destined for international markets. The lens of political ecology helps make sense of what is happening here. Right? In this frame, the boat slicing through the Gulf is a manifestation of capital, and the interactions that we witness on the boat are driven as much by global economic processes and markets as they are by other factors such as regulatory regimes. The lens of marine ecology helps us understand how extensive the impact of this practice is, particularly the removal of juvenile fishes and invertebrates, as well as benthic habitat destruction. The Gulf, dubbed the world's aquarium by Jacques Cousteau, is one of the most biodiverse areas on the planet, and it is under great threat through this practice and other perils. In approaching the interactions we witness on the trawler, we also pay attention to the multiple co-productive bodies and processes, including the workers, who along with the captain do not own the boat, to technology's role in the fishing practice, including the regulatory turtle excluder devices that trawlers are required to use but do so inconsistently, to the boat's location in the Gulf, skirting the boundary between Mexican and indigenous Comcac waters, to the water currents and weather affecting the boat's path, to the birds that arrive to eat shrimp heads and the sea lions that swim alongside, and to our own positionality as researchers. And what of the role of shrimp-eating humans? Is there something in that moment when shrimp, the number one seafood in the U.S., melts in a human mouth, a sense of pleasure of eating, that partly drives what's happening on the boat? Okay. When a set is first dropped upon the deck, it is one squirming mass. The difference between individuals caught in the net collapses under the weight of the pile. The method for calculating bycatch involves shoveling a random sample from the set and then setting it aside to weigh and inventory as representative of the set. Then we begin to differentiate, raking through the pile to identify and record all species present, placing those of concern to the side to later measure and weigh. All along, we toss shrimp into the baskets as well, becoming a part of the boat's labor. Our individual encounters with bycatch become a hinge for our collaboration, which includes a series of poems and drawings addressed to particular individuals, kind of in the form of the literary field guide, but doing something a little different with that. And each poem and illustration is, in a sense, that you see the poems on the back, excerpts from the poems on the back of those cards coming around, a snapshot or winnowing of the interactions on the boat. The poems begin filtered through an individual human subjectivity, through a direct second-person you address, and then open out into multiple allusions and references to the many bodies interacting on the boat. So I'm going to read just one of the poems from that project, a full poem, and then show you just a few slides of an art exhibit that we currently have up on the at the University of Arizona Museum of Art. Those are the cards. So this is for the shovel-nosed guitarfish. So these poems and drawings, like I said, were a way for us to try to make sense of that pile that you saw on the boat, which kind of can be really overwhelming being in the midst of that for all night. The rhythm of the boat rocks your fins like a Stratocaster, only quiet, not plugged in yet. The amp, then with reverb, pedals on the boat deck while you'll be tossed into a basket. Maybe it's better than being shoveled out the hatch where the lobos and pelicanos wait. Though your name also reminds me of Picasso, three musicians fragmented. This pile of fish, maybe cubist space, is the best way of approaching it. This assemblage on the deck of a boat in the Gulf of California, where humans take shovels like snow shovels clearing a path after a storm and scrape surplus life out those openings. At least that is not you. You will be in a basket and then onto shore and maybe into the fish taco that I will later order. And I won't think of your eyes, eyes with stars for pupils, your soft body and my fish-stained gloves, cold hands. The rhythm of your slow gestation, more like a bass line than lead guitar, or the dumb luck of spatial and temporal overlap where you gather, like you're ready for the nets, like the nets maybe would be a vacation from the long maturation, but the way they drag up everything in their path, but the way they drag up everything in their path. So there's a series of poems and drawings that we've done to address to them that are, you know, in the cards. Here's the loggerhead sea turtle that you see coming around. Here's the bullseye pufferfish, and these are also part of an exhibit that I mentioned that we have at the University of Arizona, where we have set up a very sleek-looking bar table with real-looking shrimp cocktails and shrimp cocktail glasses, and with video from the boat on the wall. You know, here you can see a close-up of the shrimp cocktails and a menu that actually has excerpts from some of the poems. Because what we wanted to do is kind of connect the food systems, because a lot of the shrimp that, you know, is fished there ends up, you know, in the U.S. ends up where, you know, where people are, you know, eating, you know, shrimp in Tucson. So we want to just kind of like show some of the interactions that are happening, you know, for that to get there and do this as an art exhibit. And, you know, we have a poem, parts of poems on the wall, right? So this is another way of putting, you know, scholarly work out there, putting it out as an exhibit. And this, I think, connects a lot with, you know, our conversations that we'll have in terms of interpretation and history and public history. You know, we bring, this was what, last week or 2 weeks ago, we brought an environmental studies class into the exhibit, kind of to think about, okay, what's happening here? You know, what's going on with the, with what stories are being told, what stories have we left out about the interactions, and get them responding to that, you know, using these kinds of spaces. You know, and I know you've talked about looking at, you know, going across the grounds and seeing how the interpretation of some of the some of the sculptures on campus here are they're you know, very ripe for, you know, thinking about interpretation and, you know, alternative narratives and interpretation. We also, as part of this, there's a local Edible Baja Arizona, a food magazine that reaches about 90,000 people. So we just, I think it came out probably yesterday, we have a series of poems and drawings in that magazine, you know, so reaching kind of people that are interested in food systems that way as well. So that's just, I wanted to share that because that's kind of the current project that's on my mind. You know, you're always thinking about the current project, but they all kind of have, there's the shame-faced crab that looks shame-faced because it puts its claws up like that. They all, you know, they all, I think about them, you know, in as a practice, right? I think about them all as ways of trying to pay attention to what's happening in a certain situation and then, you know, design something from that. And one of the ways, one of the ways that I think about that as well is through, obviously through poetry, as I've mixed poetry in throughout the day. But we printed for you a short broadside of one of my poems that's a series of instructions. And I'm actually going to finish on this, so that we have a little time for conversation. And this is a, you can think of it as a prompt or its instructions. Everyone get one? So I'll read this and I'll finish on this. Various instructions for the practice of poetic field research. Note your elevation above sea level. What poems occur here? Map the quarter mile radius around your home in a poem. Draw a line. On one side of the line, note observations. On the other side, write responses to those observations. Which is which? Choose an object in your field. Make the object the title. Make it the title three times. Write three pieces with this title. List everything that is alive around you. List everything that is not alive around you. Go to a different elevation. What poems occur here? Choose a species you know little bit about, but that lives in your ecosystem. Learn everything you can about that species. Then, go find the species. Write what happens. The first object poem, scene number 4, will be your control. Analyze the second and third against the control. What are your conclusions? Find an urban ecotone. Stand there. Write a poem from the dual space. Imagine a rise in sea level. How will that affect your elevation poem? List everything that is natural around you. List everything that is not natural around you. Observe lists 5 and 11. Why did you organize them as you did? Is there such a thing? Stand up and put your arms out. The length of your arms is the circle of the poem. Choose a field you know little about. Find someone in that field to interview. Research the person's work beforehand so that you can ask relevant questions. Conduct the interview, then write a poem. Write a poem that takes place over 4.5 billion years. Write a poem that is 3 degrees Celsius warmer than it is now. So, thank you. Thank you. And yeah, thank you. I've all of those projects, of course, I'm speaking about them, but there are many collaborators on all of those projects. You know, Maria Johnson, the collaborator on the Bycatch project, Paul and Chris on the book, NEH, you know, many collaborators, so thanks to all of them as well. So, and I think we left good time for...
I'll jump in and say one thing.
Okay.
And then I will let you handle...
Okay.
Thank you. I just wanted to make some quick comments to segue to the question and answer. Just for those of you who are historians or who are in my class, hopefully you're starting to think about ways that this intersects with what we're talking about for our research, and we'll pick up on all of that tomorrow. I wanted to kind of point out that some of the most important, I love how you describe this, and I'm so happy to have you elaborate on all of these different elements of your work, because they reach into so many different, you know, things that I've been thinking about. So one of the most important ones I'd like to just highlight is how all of these practices and, well, forms like this are asking us to stop and think and reflect and, you know, creating space for a new narrative. So they're not dictating narratives necessarily, they're offering interpretations and sort of encouraging the audience or participant to also create his or her own narrative. And so this is one of the things that I see intersecting with public history, like you were saying about the prepositions, kind of interpreting or rethinking with people, with communities, and working as much as possible from original sources. So original sources can be representations, they can be poems, or they could be historical documents. Another thing that intersects with what historians do is kind of picking up fragments of things and trying to make sense of them, sometimes rearranging the fragments into other forms of organization. And then there's the blurring of boundaries between fiction and history. So this is something that's kind of too big to talk about for me to say something quick about it, but we'll maybe talk about that tomorrow. And you know, the idea isn't to completely lose the boundary between history and fiction, but rather to think about how creative processes might challenge our ways of thinking about history or representation. And the other thing is the process of documentation is also an act of kind of creating a historical record or archive. So the way that these poems document things, even in a creative way, or something as more direct as like a photograph or a video or things like that. These are ways of documenting moments and that create records and archives for later interpretation as well. So these are kind of some of the ways that I'm thinking about the intersections with your work, which I'm sure that everyone in here who are from different disciplines might have other ideas about how it's intersecting with what they're doing. And so I would love to hear from everyone, and I will let you maybe handle the questions. Okay. That seems to be easier with one microphone and everything. But I also wanted to thank the Center for Public History and our lovely people who are helping us back there for everything.
I second that. Thank you so much. Yeah. It's a treat to be here.
So if anyone has any questions or comments.
Provocations.
About his work on the rings of Saturn and looking at like the, I'm overfishing of the herring, and using just an alternative way to bring a kind of empathy with, you know, an industry that said, well, we know the fish don't suffer at all, so
this is the law. Right.
Do you see your own work as, I feel like Zabel's trying to, like, do things where we see the humanity, or the humanity in things that are not human necessarily, but I feel like just from what you read, you were talking about maybe not emphasizing that theme, but doing something like coexistence, the co-life, living. I guess, is there something that you feel like you're trying to develop specifically in your work about that?
With the bycatch project, right? It's the bycatch project has been very, it's pushed me in a lot of different ways. That's great to think. I know Sebald's work a little bit, but I haven't like connected it as much with it with this. But I'm gonna do that now. There's this one really interesting project. So the video that we have on the wall is part of the exhibit. It's about a 15-minute video. So you saw about a 1-minute clip of bycatch, but there are different pieces of it, and. One of the things that we wanted to be very careful about in this project too is in terms of thinking about the multiple like bodies, right? And when I think of the bodies that are involved in it, from the fish bodies to the human bodies to the laborers who work on the trawler boats to the communities to the local indigenous and small-scale fisher communities and their effects, and kind of, you know, really thinking about that. So, you know, one thing we wanted to be careful about in the exhibit is not just like having the exhibit be a didactic thing where we say like eating shrimp is bad, although I don't eat shrimp anymore after, you know, being in this, but like to say it's more complicated. There's so much going on here, right? And we have a lot of great respect for the people that are working on the boats. Like, I mean, being on the boats, I mean, we become part of labor. We work, you know, with them when we're working there. So it's very complicated. You know, quickly. So there's so much in this project, you know, that so much to think about in terms of geographically too, sort of like the commodity chain afterwards. That's one of the next steps that we're going to work on for the next version of this exhibit. One piece of there's the Century Ethnography Lab. Has anyone heard of that? Out of I think it's at Harvard. If you looked up the Century Ethnography Lab, they have a movie, a documentary movie on New England, I think it's a cod boat, but a New England boat, and they, excuse me, it's about an hour and 20 minute documentary, no narration, right? And it's all just kind of like working in the, like the sensory interactions that are happening there, sort of presenting what's happening, and sort of like the multiple layers of trauma, actually, that are happening to the bodies on the boat. So, that project is, like I said, it's like currently ongoing, so there's so much, you know, to think through, and it brings up a lot of ways to think about it. Yeah.
Eric, so much to talk about. Thanks so much, and I love the book.
Thank you.
I want to bring to your attention some of the things that this book brought me back, being from the Sonoran Desert.
Okay, great, yeah.
From the other side of the border, though.
Where are you from?
At Mosillo.
Okay.
So I think there are certain things that that I wanted to ask you about, and if there's no time to answer them all, we can talk about it later.
Yeah.
So there's another set of different literary projects that can be created in this an ecology of text around the Sonoran Desert, not only about of this book, but previous works like Amy Sarah Carroll's Transported Immigrant Tool, right?
Mm-hmm.
So how do we think not only about ecopoetics in the way that you're doing them by the specificity of the name, but sometimes actually neglecting a little bit of the of the impact that humans do have in the environment, because this is not only a land of the flower, but also of the bulldozer, right?
Right.
But also, how do we think about this desert not only being, you know, this incredible place that I love, but also a place of death with all the migrants and the right? Which is what the immigrant, transported immigrant tool addresses, right?
Mm-hmm.
Also in an eco-poetic way,
right?
I think. So that's one of the first things that I wanted to mention. Also, I think what I find really interesting is that there are certain things that are in the book that have another name in Sonora.
Mm-hmm.
That are maybe, I don't know if you think of translation of this book,
mm-hmm.
because like there's the a simple example, the Mochomo, which is the red ant of the desert,
right.
Or the Porowi, which is the a striped lizard, or the Chukata, that is the sap of the mesquite, or the Pechita, that are the cherries of the mesquite.
Right.
Those are all this language that comes from the Seri and the Yaqui and
mm-hmm.
the Papago languages
uh-huh.
that are incorporated into Spanish and that we use in a naturalized way
mm-hmm.
by referring to this, like Copechis, Churea, Cachora, Choya, right?
Right?
All of this comes from the same place,
right.
which is appropriations of language from the original use
right.
of the word, and also the that signaled the relationship that were before colonialism and before colonial languages took place, like English and Spanish as well.
Right.
So I want to just ask you about that, because there's a poem that you actually uses Papago, right?
Uh-huh.
The Tolono
right.
Language, but there's some other places that is I think that is missing
right.
in that way. And in the end, my third question would be, how about so this is like the butterfly effect with the Gulf of California, right? Especially with the Totoaba and the
right,
Marina,
right?
That has been exploited by the Chinese black market of the bladder of the Totoaba that
right.
is actually killing in a very, horrible way, the Vaquita Marina.
Right.
So how do you address that actually also with this project, right?
Right.
The most visible and the invisible
mm-hmm.
species that are
mm-hmm.
in the news and not in the news.
Right.
The Totoaba's bladder is like $3,000 each.
Right, right.
So those are like my main
right.
ideas.
No, that's great. That's great. And so
you're Bruno, right? You're
yes.
Right.
Yes.
I look forward to getting into question this conversation in more depth. I'll say just a couple quick responses now. One, one of the limitations of this book is that it is largely it's largely based around the Tucson community. So it's mostly poets from Tucson. So I've done events in Phoenix as well too. We have one or two poets from Phoenix. We have a few poets from Sonora in here, but it's largely Tucson centric. So the desert goes out more from there. And that was a question too. I mean, we have the common English name and the Latin name, and a few of them we have some of the other names for them. Right, 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 right. So, I mean, my dream of like sort of a next version of this. I mean, there's only 60 species too, right? Right, and each different writer has a sort of different take. And thinking about like one of the comments that Kristen had earlier too, in terms of thinking about what narratives. What narratives are there, and kind of this becomes, the poems become a document as well too, right? So one of the things that I was careful about in writing it, and I'm not sure if we always do here, and the different voices do, but sort of what sort of narratives are replicated in the poems, what sort of narratives are replicated in the field guide entries as well too, and where can we push against some of those, right? We try to do that in some of these as well too. It would be great to, I'm talking with a poet, Oscar de la Cardenas, I think, in Hermosillo, about, he's working on some, bilingual edition of something, like this. So I think that would be kind of, one of the next, the next things in there. As for the Vaquita and sort of the question of the Totoaba, and really the way that I think about the last question is in terms of like, can art and poetry like make changes in the world? What does it do? That's kind of part what I'm the way that I'm taking part of your last question, in terms of like And that is, I think it does in affecting individual perceptions. Like I think about that story that I started with the you know, the people interacting with the scorpion one line poem and how that sort of like changed the way that people, you know, interacted with that environment. But as a social scientist, that's one of the, you know, main questions that I think about, and as one of the next questions for my research as well too. And maybe this is, you know, a question for public history as well too, in terms of how we actually kind of, because I make claims many times, and I believe it, and I can point to things that, you know, this are, you know, in the bycatch project, for example, is meant to kind of bring awareness to an ecological, a socio-ecological process that's happening in the Gulf, and the trauma that it does on, you know, on both, you know, human and non-human communities on the, in the Gulf, right? But then the question is, okay, how do you measure like what that does, and does it, you know, have an effect on policy, an effect on changing in what we do next, right? So thinking about ways of doing that, actually, one of the, you know, things that I've been thinking more and more about and thinking about in relationship to some of your work too is doing sort of collaborative ethnographies in exhibits, collaborative ethnographies in sort of, you know, responses to the way people, you know, read something like this, right? I think of that also, that each of the different poems in here and the writings in here, you know, is sort of a marking of at a certain time and place with, you know, different, you know, different different perspectives, different subjectivities behind each poem or each piece, a sort of a marking of a human and non-human relationship that then could be, you know, kind of, you know, critiqued through eco-criticism, through different ways of, you know, thinking about what that, you know, what sort of relationship is portrayed there. So that might have got a little bit on this, but I want to have more conversations. Yeah, on this. It's great. Yeah.
I'm from the English department.
So okay,
I'm
great.
Very familiar with, you know, form and literature, uh-huh. Narrative form, mm-hmm. And I'm really intrigued by the. I mean, it's an unlikely pairing of a poet and a geographer, at least as far as I'm aware. Mm-hmm. And I'm really interested in you mentioned talking about form in terms in landscape terms or in terms of geography, and I'd really love to hear you talk just a little bit more about that version of form, how it works for you, and how being a poet makes you think differently about, you know, geographical form, or how being a geographer makes you think differently about poetic form.
Right, it's a great question.
By the way, thank you for this talk.
Oh, you're welcome.
I have not read the book, and I'm going to buy it immediately.
Okay.
And thank you, Kristen. I'll talk to you afterward.
Yeah.
Thank you for sending the flyer to me.
We have space on the field trip.
I can't.
That's why
okay.
Unfortunately.
Anyone who wants to come, can come.
But so, thank you for the talk.
Yeah.
It was really engaging.
Thank you for that. So form and content, I'll do it a few different ways. Like, so I actually first come at it, so I kind of was a poet before I was a geographer, whatever that means, you know, and I think about form and content, and I think about sort of projective verse and Robert Creeley and Charles Olson, kind of like that each poem, you know, each the content makes its own form, right? And, you know, so I think that way. As a geographer, I kind of, you know, I've been working on developing this idea of geopoetics, right? So geopoetics with intersections with, you know, eco-poetics, like housemaking, like eco-poesis, you know, being housemaking, geopoetics being earthmaking, right? So I think about it in a couple of different ways. You know, one, I think about how I can, you know, practically when I'm, you know, working, I've been putting pieces of poetry into more scholarly, you know, articles and putting them out that way. So kind of like blending this like creative and critical mode, right? So a critical mode, which really kind of, you know, goes towards, you know, wanting to have, you know, some sort of analytic precision, and creative mode that kind of does more of, you know, catalytic and like interpretive excess is something that desired in it. So kind of, you know, playing with those. As a geographer, I mean, think about it like in terms of scale. I think of scale, and I think of bodies, and I think of relationship. So I think about, you know, biogeography. Like that Mesquite poem is about biogeography in a sense, right? So it's about like landscape and, you know, landscape change, plant change over time, you know, so like time and space, you know, change. But I also think about how, you know, bodies broadly, you know, kind of interact with sites, right? And thinking about, I think about poetics as a sense of, you know, of making in the world and acting in the world. I don't know if that, you know, that gets at it some.
That's partly what you mean by working on placemaking
projects. Right, right. And yeah, placemaking and kind of trying to think, so there's this idea of kind of trying to work off of, you know, a naive methodology as well, in a sense, too. So when I think as a social scientist, right, you're trained to kind of go out into the world and kind of like categorize things very quickly. And I mean, all of these projects are about categorization. But as a geographer, you know, trying to go into a place or a site and kind of suspend the categories for as long as possible before I say, oh, this is natural, or this is not natural, or this kind of human body, this is this kind of non-human body, you know, and trying to pay really close attention to kind of naively kind of the interactions that are happening there, and then build off of that sort of methodologically is one way that I think in terms of spatial theory within geography. But
one really quick follow-up.
Yeah.
Do you insert bits of poetry into articles that get published in like scholarly geographic?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And they're buying them.
Most of the time. Sometimes I've gotten some pushback too. So I mean, there's a long history of humanities work within geography as well too,
yes.
Right? And there's actually the American Association of Geographers, which is our, you know, big association, just a couple years ago started a new journal called Geohumanities. So they're pushing for this kind of work, and there's a really interesting. And part of that, I think is a response to many of the big challenges that we face in the world today, you know, namely, you know, climate change, namely, you know, these kinds of things, more and more we realize they can't be faced even within like one scientific discipline. That, you know, the collaboration is really important. And there's kind of been an opening in thinking about, okay, what do the environmental humanities broadly bring to this? And there's, you know, more and more openings for that. So yeah, so I do get some pushback sometimes, but you know, so let's see. You know. But it's funny, one last thing on that. So like when I'm in a room of geographers, I'm a poet. When I'm in a room of poets, I'm a geographer, like that kind of thing too, right? So you kind of like, yeah.
Mm-hmm. I may be unlike anybody else in this room. I just heard about this today because I'm visiting a friend who works at the university, and he told me I'd be interested in this, and I was. But I won't belabor all how this is similar to some stuff that I'm working on myself, but I want to ask a question just to get right to it. I know a lot of instances in what you're talking about where you're resisting something,
uh-huh.
You know, a sort of like univocal science, or, you know, you mentioned with the bycatch product, there's you're trying to bring awareness to something. So, you know, I'm looking at this and also wondering, when you say, with, you know, another way of interpreting things, I just wonder, I kind of pushing towards a question where I would wonder if you could just tell us more concretely what it is you're resisting in your work.
Mm-hmm.
It's there for me, at least.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
In this conversation.
I think that, it depends on, you know, I think about each project a little differently, but I think you picked up something. Resistance, I think about one of the roles of art, when I think about myself like in relationship to as an artist or putting art in the world, one of the roles of art is to critique, right? And, you know, the critique is, I think, sometimes married to, I don't know if that's a good word to use there, to resistance, right? But I think, to answer it simply, I guess, I'm more and more resistant of a universe, and thinking about this idea of a multiverse, right? And many people have talked about this. So you're talking about like having, you know, multiple narratives, multiple stories, you know, going through here. In the work that I do and that I want to do, my hope is that what I put out into the world resists certain narratives that are based on fear, that are based on extraction, that are based on certain mindsets of a human relationship with other humans or with the rest of the world that is based on antagonism, right? And more something that's based on cooperation and mutual care and you know, and connection versus disconnection. So that's kind of what I'd say, you know, in terms of like what I'd be resisting, what I'd be, you know, hoping for in my work. The question is, when you do that, you're kind of, each thing you put out in the world, you're reproducing certain narratives, right? And you know, it's even like writing these the field guide forms, one of the things that I was resisting in writing them, and I don't think we always did it, is that if you go through, I mean, I'm like a field guide, you know, I grew up as a field guide junkie too, like bird guides and as a naturalist and stuff. And there's a certain kind of like box in the way that field guides generally work too, and certain kind of, you know, organizations of the world, you know. For one thing, like the field guide entries, you know, in most field guide texts are very rarely like heteronormative, right? So, you know, and I see that sort of like, you know, cultural idea being placed on an art, on, you know, human understanding of how, you know, nature works, right? So there's a few places in here where we try to resist that in this book. So, you know, it happens at like specific instances like that, but happens as like an overall approach. Does that?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I just, maybe to push you just a little bit further.
Good.
This is that, like, so I came from the social sciences and humanities.
Uh-huh.
And kind of was born along through the sort of antagonisms that those disciplines have had with science.
Uh-huh.
And as I've gone out away from academia to do my own explorative thinking, I've gone into geology quite a bit.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I think geology is a really special science, actually. And the more that I get involved in these kinds of conversations, the more I find myself strangely defending science,
mm-hmm.
versus any sort of you know, wafting sense that science is this homogeneous methodology that likes to describe what things are.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, the more that I've gotten involved with the science explicitly as a student of it, there I confront the edge of science, which is just completely enamored with the mystery of it.
Right.
So I'm wondering how much of this stuff, you know, how much of it do you find yourself feeling like you're resisting? Okay. I guess maybe I'll just back out. I won't give you that question, but I just wonder how much science is, you're finding that there isn't one science, or that there's a multiplicity of sciences, and some mm-hmm. of which are worth resisting and others which mm-hmm. are mm-hmm. helping you. Maybe that's the
mm-hmm. question. Yeah. I mean, sometimes I, you know, call myself a scientist, and I mean, science is, there's very, you know, different, you know, many different, you know, modes of doing that work. Maybe, you know, maybe another way to say about it is, maybe in one sense what I'm not necessarily even resisting as much as playing, you know, and playing with material in a way, right, and putting it out in different ways. But I think one of the things that I think about really interesting right now in terms of the conversations between social sciences, humanities, and physical sciences is around the concept of the Anthropocene, right, this idea of the Anthropocene that has kind of, is this boundary object. So some of the work I do in science is in terms of like the, you know, social studies of science and sort of boundary objects as how people come to the table together, right, and Anthropocene, this is a whole nother talk, but Anthropocene is a really interesting concept geologically, also through the social science, the way humanities scholars have taken it up, and what it implies in many different ways. So yeah. So I don't mean to say that like I prefer this way of knowing over this. I mean, and there are, you know, there are lots of facts that we know, you know, from science, and facts exist in the world, and they're important to pay attention to. You know, that's not at all what I mean with multiverse, but just being aware of different. Yeah.